mountains with an extreme topography characterized by steep slopes and narrow villages. The forests along these steep slopes are protecting the villages in the narrow valleys against avalanches, rockfalls, landslides, and wild waters. Life without these forests would not be possible. Therefore, the sustainability of the forests is essential for the development as a whole. Back in the 19th century, deforestation was a big issue in Switzerland. The Industrial Revolution led to a sharp increase of population, and wood was at that time the only available resource. The increased demand for construction and firewood triggered an uncontrolled deforestation. The consequences in the second half of the 19th century were devastating. Avalanches, landslides, rock fallings, and flood destroyed many of these villages. Against this background, the Swiss government was forced to take drastic measures by introducing the first time the principle of sustainability in a forest law in 1876. This law is still the backbone of our forestry policy. It says, as a rule, deforestation is prohibited. In exceptional cases, a deforestation permit may be granted, but for all deforestation, compensation in kind must be provided in the same region. The result of this policy is that the surface of forests in Switzerland increased by more than 30% during the last 140 years. Lessons learned of our experience. Social forestry plays a key role and rests on strong institutions. Actually, we don't know anything else than social forestry in Switzerland. I think what we also understood that ownership for the respect and for the maintaining the forests is very crucial. And we have in Switzerland, I think, the situation where all stakeholders still are very much backing this forest law. Today, it's about accommodating interests of protecting the forests with sustainable agriculture and with sustainable tourism. Now, this own experience might also explain why Switzerland is supporting sustainable forestry all over the world, including Southeast Asia. One prominent example is the ASEAN-Swiss partnership on social forestry and climate change. And with this project, we want to support three main things: that social forestry should be integrated in an overall policy. The second is it's important to share experience between the different ASEAN member countries about best practices in social forestry. And the third objective of this project is to build capacity. I would take also this opportunity to announce the next ASEAN Social Forestry conference. It will highlight the theme on enhancing livelihood and conservation benefits through social forestry for a green ASEAN community in Koto Kinabalu, Sabah, from the 21st to the 26th of May. I wish you all a good discussion forum. Thank you very much.
I'd like to invite Dr. Ramon Razal. If we can pass this mic over here. Oh, you have one. Oh, great.
Thank you. Good evening. Selamat sore.
This is a study that I undertook together with our moderator, Ms. Chrissy Guerrero, of the Non-Timber Forest Products Exchange Program. And we are thankful to all the respondents and the organizations that provided us with the data that we collected on technologies that are available for non-timber forest products in the region. And if I don't mention your technology, it's not because your technology is important. It's not important just because I only have 10 minutes for this discussion. The inspiration to this study was the experience of the non-timber forest products exchange program in initiating the tie-up or the linkage between the Cambodia resin gatherers and the researchers at the Forest Products Research and Development Institute in Los Baños. The resin gatherers in Cambodia are an impoverished group. They do not get enough value from the resins that they gather. And what they did was, what NTFP did was to link them with the researchers at FPRDI in the Philippines, which helped identify the components present in the resin, and consequently, this has helped improve the processing and utilization of resin in Cambodia. Next, please. The outline of presentation is as shown. Next, please. And for the six countries that we visited, we have a long list of different non-timber forest products. Next, please. And we are highlighting here the non-timber forest products that have received considerable research attention in the countries that we visited, and also some degree of commercialization. Next, please. And as for the trends in as far as utilization and processing of non-timber forest products is concerned, there is a wide range of NTFPs, including bamboo, rattans, palms, resins, wild food, and medicinal plants. And next, please. And what we have noticed is that for similar non-timber forest products, there is varying degree of utilization and therefore benefits derived by the forest-based communities across countries. In many areas, the NTFPs remain unprocessed at the community level, and we have noticed that a visionary, a leader is important in the community to initiate or pursue value addition and enterprise development activities. Next, please. And we have also noticed that gatherers and producers of non-timber forest products, while they initiate the value chain, the performance of this vital function is grossly underrated because they don't get much value from the harvesting of the NTFPs. Next, please. And to show how important NTFPs are, an estimated 300 million people in the ASEAN region are dependent on the forest. And mostly these are indigenous peoples whose customary ways are linked closely with non-timber forest products. Non-timber forest products account for as much as 25% of the income of close to 1 billion people globally. Next, please. And what we have noticed also is that the gathering or production of non-timber forest products are largely undocumented or poorly recorded. And there is an existence of local markets that where the local people can sell their products, and also significant cross-border, mainly illegal markets. And for the commercially traded products, the volumes of globally traded products are fluctuating. And we have also observed that intra-regional NTFP trade, meaning trade between ASEAN member countries, are small compared to trade between ASEAN and the rest of the world. Next, please. For the scope of the study, we simply looked at the different products and processes that are used to convert NTFPs. And the objective of this is to determine what technologies can be shared across countries, with the end in view of finding technologies that can be shared, that can address the emergence of the green economy. And by technology, we mean interventions or activities that can add value to the resource, primarily for the gatherers, the processors, at the community level to gain higher benefit from these products. And as mentioned, we have visited six countries. These are Malaysia, Indonesia, Myanmar, Laos, Cambodia, and the Philippines. And basically, we interviewed representatives of government organizations, NGOs. And we had actually very few time available to visit private and actual NTFP processing operations. Next, please. And we have observed that the R&D on developing technologies for bamboo dominate the R&D activities in the six countries visited, encompassing propagation, plantation development, product development, pole preservation, as well as analysis of bamboo value chains. As far as rattan technologies are concerned, what stands out is what Laos is doing. It has undergone certification of rattan forest, and the rattan are delivered to a certified manufacturer who is a NFC chain of custody certified, and he makes products following sustainable designs with minimal use of materials, less waste, and avoid the use of nails and fasteners. However, this is an isolated case, and the efforts for certification of rattan have to be replicated. Next, please. In the Philippines, there is a Cebu Furniture Industries Federation that produces innovative high-end furniture designs. They use mixed materials. So aside from rattan, they use vines, bamboo, marble to make furniture products. And they continuously train the workforce to become more skilled in furniture making and design. Next, please. At the Forest Research Institute in Malaysia, they formulate and develop an array of plant-based health products, such as nutraceuticals, cosmeceuticals, and they do this in collaboration with the private sector and the community to ensure the sustainable supply of plant materials. Next, please. In Indonesia, they were able to develop an inoculation method to infect the acacia tree to accumulate the resin. And this involves the use of liquid preparation of tree-compatible inoculant strains, which are injected to the tree at the right time to induce the formation of resin-rich acacia wood. Next, please. And in Cambodia, there is an enterprise that undertakes the drying of coryphal leaves, and they were also able to develop a mechanical bundling equipment prior to the shipment of the leaves to Vietnam. Basically, that is the one that is used to make the Vietnam hats. Next, please. And a long list of other technologies and innovations, like in Indonesia. We have colleagues here who will talk about the Indonesian Forest Honey Network. And again, I mentioned this earlier, the composition of the dipterocarp resin in Cambodia has been determined, which expanded uses and enabled better tapping and harvesting and handling practices that increase the value for resin gatherers. Also in Cambodia, they were able to document the sources and collection methods for wild food recipes, and they found that food is adulterated when you add synthetic condiments. And consequently, they also developed agro-system models for better management and conservation of the forest for food. Next, please. In the Philippines, we have a Philippine Textile Research Institute that developed environment-friendly extraction processes from different plant sources. And they were able to develop technology to convert the extracts into dye powder for longer shelf life, convenience and transport, and a broad range of other applications. Next, please. Next, please. Oops. Next, please. Okay. And among the issues and that we have been able to identify as a result of the study is the paucity of research on non-timber forest products. A recurring theme here in this conference is the paucity of research overall in forestry. But consider that NTFE products are a minor component of forest, and therefore, the research activities is even much smaller compared to the research being done on timber resources. There is also a mismatch between non-timber forest products research priorities and actual gaps. our colleagues in Cambodia complained, in Myanmar complained that the NGOs have very little information to share with the communities that they serve because the research institute does not conduct a lot of research that will be useful to the community. We also have problems with sustainability of non-timber forest products. Data on non-timber forest products are lacking, and there are methodological problems to determine how adequate the resource is to meet the demands of industry. Next, please. And of course, we have problems with availability and access to information. Communities that need information on technologies for non-timber forest products are basically remote relative to the location of the research institutes, and therefore they cannot access updated information on NTFPs. There is also a problem with access to financing, especially in the acquisition of equipment that is needed to convert non-timber forest products. And in terms of scaling up and transforming NTFPs, this requires long-term studies, but basically the funders of research on NTFPs, like government, is impatient on research results that can be generated. Next, please. And of course, it's also important to highlight the role of policy. We have noted that relatively the policies are inadequate in most of the countries that we have visited. And as a result, households, communities, and the private sector are not able to set out long-term plans for plantation and business enterprise development. Of course, in contrast, Indonesia has recently completed a set of NTFP-specific policies. And also in Cambodia, they have provided a 3-year tax break for community-based honey enterprise. Overall, contradicting policies remain that continue to hamper the NTFP sector development across the region. Next, please. So for our recommendations, especially in regard to what the ASEAN can do, we would like to have a network of institutions in different ASEAN countries created, established on the basis of the strengths or the capacity that exists in each of these countries. We also are recommending the creation of an ASEAN expert working group on non-timber forest products that will provide regional cooperation among the proposed country-based centers. And we hope that non-timber forest products will be included as part of these programs. National policy should be more aggressive in promoting
the ASEAN economic community. The research done by Chandra and Co. this 2014 shows that though 65 to 99% of all businesses in ASEAN countries are micro, small, medium enterprises, there hasn't been a lot of focus. There hasn't been a lot of benefit for this group. So we're trying to see how we can involve that, especially in the social forestry sector. So I turn over to a small enterprise to Pak Rakib to share their community forestry and their forest honey experience. So please kindly use the translation device as well. Thank you. Sorry for the film. Can we shut the lights, please?
Mereka melakukan ritual pengambilan lebah hutan.
Kami sangat konsen ya untuk menjaga daripada kualitas madu hutan ini karena pertama tadi kita sudah berkomitmen dari awal untuk mengembalikan brand image daripada madu Sumbawa. Jadi selama ini kita tetap dengan melakukan pelatihan-pelatihan di tingkat kelompok dengan terutama ya tentang sistem panen lestari dan higienis dengan sistem tiris untuk memperbaiki daripada kualitas madu ini.
Madu hutan merupakan salah satu produk yang sangat kita pandang dan beberapa analisa melihat bahwa madu hutan merupakan produk yang sangat organik dan bisa dikembangkan menjadi sebuah produk yang menjadi gaya hidup sehat masyarakat saat ini.
menurut kami di sini hutan ini sangat mendukung untuk perkembangan madu di sini, sehingga kami di sini tidak ada kayaknya penebangan, perladangan, tidak ada. Cuman kita hanya menanam kemiri sama kopi aja.
Jaring madu semua ini mulai di seluruh, hampir seluruh kecamatan ada, terutama yang berdekatan dengan hutan anggotanya. Jadi kita harapkan, kita himbau mereka tidak lagi menebang pohon, tapi menjaga pohonnya juga.
Madu Sumbawa ini munculnya bagus, rasanya juga ternyata bagus, karena selama ini kita baru 2,5 tahun sudah lebih dari 11 ton madu Sumbawa yang kita berhasil memasarkan. Jadi kalau kita mau memaju konsumsi daripada madu di Indonesia, ya kita harus memastikan supaya mutu dari produk yang dihasilkan selalu memenuhi standar yang sudah ditentukan.
Sumbawa tentu merupakan salah satu potensi yang dimiliki oleh Indonesia. Pemberdayaan ekonomi yang kami bangun di madu hutan Sumbawa adalah bagaimana meningkatkan kelestarian hutan, bagaimana meningkatkan kesejahteraan hidup masyarakat setempat. Tentu BNI berharap siapapun yang menjadi petani binaan BNI, dalam hal ini mampu meningkat kesejahteraan hidupnya, mampu meningkat pengetahuannya, dan insya Allah madu hutan Sumbawa mampu menebus pasar global.
Prakarsa Jaringan Madu Hutan Indonesia atau JMHI. Jaringan Madu Hutan Indonesia lahir pada tahun 2005 dengan sekretariat di Yayasan Riak Bumi Pontianak, dan PD Dianiaga Jakarta adalah bagian pemasarannya. JMHI didirikan untuk melestarikan hutan sebagai habitat lebah, untuk meningkatkan pendapatan petani madu dan menghormati kearifan lokal. Sekarang ada 9 mitra pendukung, lebih dari 1,000 petani madu di 8 pulau di Indonesia. Jaringan Madu Hutan Sumbawa bergabung di JMHI pada tahun 2007. Melalui Jaringan Madu Hutan Indonesia, Jaringan Madu Hutan Sumbawa mulai menggunakan metode panen yang berkelanjutan dan pengelolaan higienis karena adanya permintaan pasar madu yang berkualitas. Anggota Jaringan Madu Hutan Sumbawa terdiri dari lebih dari 450 anggota dan 11 koperasi dengan seluas hutan lebih dari 17.000 hektar di Kesatuan Pemangkuan Hutan Produksi KPHP Batu Lantih Sumbawa. Kemudian kapasitas produksi Jaringan Madu Hutan Indonesia. Potensi madu hutan dari anggota Jaringan Madu Indonesia diperkirakan mencapai 200 ton per tahun. Pada tahun 2008, PD Dianiaga memasarkan 15,9 ton. Sebagian besar dijual ke MUI. Ini dibeli di tingkat komunitas sekitar 1,35 miliar atau 118,421 US dollar. Total produksi semua anggota dekat dengan 70 ton. Produksi madu hutan anggota Jaringan Madu Hutan Indonesia per tahun sejak tahun 2008 sampai dengan 2013, seperti yang kita lihat pada tabel. Salah satu contoh Jaringan Madu Hutan Sumbawa 50 ton 125 kg. Ini dilihat dari sesuai dengan keadaan iklim, karena di situ terdapat juga ada panen yang sangat sedikit. Kemudian harga madu hutan dari 2008-2013. Dengan intervensi jaringan madu hutan itu, harga madu hutan telah meningkat dari 14% sampai setinggi 321%. Harga madu hutan di tingkat petani pada tahun 2008, salah satu contoh kita lihat di tabel, yaitu di Asosiasi Petani dan Nusantarum, harga 28.000 per kilogram. Dan sekarang ini sudah mencapai pada tahun 2013 90.000 per kilogram. Di sini kita lihat bahwa ada peningkatan yang sangat signifikan dengan adanya jaringan madu hutan Indonesia. Kemudian pendapatan madu hutan dan saluran penjualan. Data jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa menunjukkan bahwa kontribusi dari madu hutan terhadap pendapatan keluarga bulanan adalah 2.500.000 atau dengan 220 US dollar. Dari koperasi yang didukung oleh jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa, mereka juga menerima pembagian keuntungan tambahan dari jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa. Kemudian penjualan dilakukan melalui jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa, toko di Sumbawa, melalui outlet lokal lainnya, dan melalui penjualan situs online selain untuk MOE. Jadi kita melihat tabel bagaimana data kontrak madu jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa dengan PD Dian Niaga Jakarta sejak tahun 2008 sampai dengan 2013. Jadi dari pertama ada 3 ton 435, kemudian 3 ton 435, pada tahun 2010 2 ton 10 kilogram, kemudian 2011 5 ton 680, tahun 2012 5 ton 900, dan tahun 2013 sama dengan 5 ton. Kemudian keuntungan jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa bergabung dengan jaringan madu hutan Indonesia. Yang pertama, pertukaran informasi meningkatkan keterampilan dari narasumber atau organisasi lokal dan internasional, terutama pada panen yang berkelanjutan. Yang kedua, pengembangan pasar bersama dan menghubungkan produsen madu hutan dengan pemain rantai nilai. Karena keberhasilan dan pengakuan jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa, organisasi yang sekarang pemegang resmi hak atas kekayaan intelektual atau HAKI, indikasi geografis IJI, madu hutan Sumbawa. Sekarang anggota jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa dapat membebaskan diri dari tengkulak dengan kondisi yang tidak menguntungkan mulai intervensi pasar yang jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa bangun. Kemudian tantangan. Peningkatan kapasitas masih diperlukan di tingkat desa dan banyak petani masih perlu dilatih dalam mengikuti standar jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa. Kemudian kelompok tani madu didukung oleh jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa masih sedikit dan dengan demikian produksi maksimum belum tercapai. Kemudian persaingan dengan pedagang. Perubahan pola cuaca telah mempengaruhi produksi madu. Terbatas staf jaringan madu hutan Sumbawa untuk memantau, memeriksa dan memperluas keanggotaan. Kemudian panggilan rekomendasi dari pemerintah Yang pertama, hendaknya menolak proyek-proyek ekonomi yang menyebabkan deforestasi dan mendukung proyek-proyek ekonomi seperti usaha hasil hutan bukan kayu yang meningkatkan kualitas hutan. Yang kedua, mendukung cara untuk mempromosikan keunikan produksi HHBK seperti melalui sertifikasi indikasi geografis. Yang ketiga, mendukung perumusan pusat madu hutan atau rencana sentra pembangunan integrasi dari hulu ke hilir di Sumbawa dan daerah lainnya oleh Kementerian Kehutanan. Yang keempat, memperjelas rencana untuk melaksanakan penegakan pendapatan retribusi pajak bagi petani madu hutan. Di tingkat ASEAN, jika ada, akan menjadi program integrasi ekonomi ASEAN, menginformasikan petani madu hutan dan produsen NTFP-EP bagaimana mereka dapat berkontribusi dan manfaat dari itu. Sektor swasta, yang pertama membantu pengembangan dan promosi madu oleh produk dan jasa terkait lainnya pariwisata di Sumbawa. Yang kedua, memfasilitasi layanan keuangan bagi petani madu hutan. Terima kasih.
Yeah, if we go to Europe, we already returned. Yeah? Almost in the map, all the map is Pak Rakib. It is far in very remote area, but we can see the blue sky, no pollution. It is a really, really good quality of honey. So, next slide. This is our common ground. Maybe I can. Don't need to explain more, but we put bee in the planet and tree as a conservation. Bee, we concern to Apis dorsata only because the other bee is Apis mellifera, Apis serrana. It is cultivated honey, madu ternak, yeah, or we call it box honey. Apis dorsata is wild. It is untamed. It is really wild. In the other hand, the people, the honey collector group, GMHI encouraged to plant a tree as the nectar sources for the bee. So this is a people bee, and the profit will explain in the later on. Next. Yeah, we focus on only Apis dorsata, the giant rock bee. It is a 1-inch, the biggest bee in the world. But it's funny, in Europe, in European community, Apis dorsata is not considered as bee, just another insect. Maybe some kind of protection. Yeah? They consider bee is only from Apis mellifera. Yeah, we also protect the habitat of bee, of course, the forest itself. Encourage the forest dwelling people, the indigenous people, to protect the habitat and give the alternative income from non-timber forest product. Build a profitable trading system with profit sharing. Provide a marketing of good quality honey and good price. Next. This is a simple value chain for supplier. A forest honey supplier and GMHI members. And Dianyaga as a, actually not production, yeah. Producer of honey is bee itself. We just do the bottling, labeling, and send to Amway. Beside of Amway, there is also a supermarket, corporate. But this is short list of chains. We also have support from Swiss Contact, for instance. Problem 2009, 2010, and 2011. There is no honey at all. So I almost get claim from Pak Kun from MOA. So we invite him, please go to the site, inspect by yourself. There is no honey at all. That is the float. yeah, there is the banjir, yeah, flood in the Danau, and the in Danau Sentarum, Lake Sentarum, there's mostly used tikung, artificial nest. So the fish get benefit from the comb, becomb. So honey collector get nothing. Pricing. Apis mellifera and Apis serrana is cultivate honey. So they have two income from the pollination services and also from the honey. That's why the honey, they can sell a little quite cheap, lower price than dorsata. And in Jakarta, of course, we compete with foreign product like manuka honey. They prefer to take manuka from New Zealand instead of our brand dorsata. Yeah. Channel distribution is very high cost for Indonesia. That's why we we consider we have the multi-level marketing in our networking for marketing. The other challenge is the education for customer. It's like this. For 1 kilo honey, the bee should visit 4 million flowers. But to produce 1 kilo for market, the bee produce 8 kilo, consume it. It's mean for 1 kilo, that is 32 million visiting to the. If we sell in the 300 gram, it is maybe close to 10 million visiting the bee foraging to the. So this is totally different if we compare with import honey from China. They put the box in the green house and put the box inside. Yeah, they produce honey, then I don't know, that is not human, not bee, like it's not treat a bee like that. Yeah, bee should be in the nature. So we also didn't show here in the presentation, before the honey collector climb the tree, they do a praying, a chanting. We call it a timang lalau. They sing a beautiful song in the middle of night. Very, very amazing. Yeah. So forest honey is a part of religion, a part of culture, a part of conservation. This is not a simple product as bought honey. It is business. This is not business at all. More complicated.
But Johnny, last minute or so.
Sorry. Yeah, research. We need a lot of research. This is the bottle of Amway. How much it is sell? It is 148,800. Close to 12 euro in retail price. And this is UKMI, Honey Islands. It's for second middle income. The next, this is dorsata. Dorsata also selling in 150,000 per 3 kilo, 300 gram. Yeah. The gift item actually is designed for Garuda and also for President Yudhoyono for the president gift item. But we wait for the 6th type. At last, we get the florist one, and we have complete 6 type in one pack. But unfortunately, the contact of the president house is I don't know. We cannot contact him. Maybe KPA take him. I don't know. So until now, we didn't success to sell this as a gift item for. The madutan is the for economic, yeah. The next. This is the market expand 2006, 2007, and 2014. We try to export, but to Holland and to Switzerland, but the price is not encouraging. You know, in the retail price in Europe, it is 4 to 5 euro per half liter. It is, if we sell it in Indonesia, three times, we can sell it in Indonesia 12 euro. So it is no point to export, I think. The last, yeah, this is the profit sharing. The group of farmer get 30% from our market, from our profit. And NGO, why NGO get 20%? Because we need NGO. The most difficult to start business is who trust who. When I must pay the honey collector with check, they refuse check. They want a bank note. But how to carry so many bank note in backpack? It is scary. 53 hours to the jungle. So the marketing is you take the honey from the forest gate and sell in very sophisticated market in Jakarta. It is very delicate job. Last year we bring 1.2 miliar rupiah. It is, yeah, a lot of money. We need NGO to do the internet and bank. Not possible to bring bank note anytime. And GMHI take 10% of profit sharing, and marketing take 40%. And this is the last.
Yeah. Slide terakhir kan?
Yeah, this is the last one.
This is the last.
Press quotation line. From the Albert Einstein. If the bee extinct from the earth, mankind have only 4 years to survive. You see the sad picture, that is the colony collapse disorder. The Apis mellifera is dying, the colony decrease. No more pollination, this is the reason, no plant, no more animal, and maybe no more mankind. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Pak Johnny.
About 450 years ago, and commonly cultivated in the mountainous area in East Timor, and 90% of the regional income are said to come from the coffee. And more than one-fourth of the family entirely depend on coffee production for their living. That means a small cultivator buys their staple food, rice or maize, and necessarily such as clothes from the coffee revenue only. The coffee revenue, on average, they can get $200 to $250 US in 2012 when I started to research in this area. And East Timor is a mountainous topography which limits the agricultural land available, and strongly seasonal climate which also limited the planting season, and the soil derived from limestone. It's actually chemically rich but physically very difficult to cultivate because during the dry season, it becomes too hard to cultivate. So the East Timor is far from the self-sufficiency of food. So this, okay, next slide, please. So this is the topography of the East Timor. As you can see from this slide, there's no vegetation due to the repeated slash and burn agriculture and also the heavy grazing by cattle and goats. And as the topsoil was almost eroded. Next slide, please. Okay, so coffee. So they actually the planting the Arabica coffee, which is internationally highly praised, and they are cultivating coffee traditional way. That means that they plant a shade tree first and waiting for approximately 10 years, and then they plant the coffee seeding beneath the shade tree. And they use no agricultural chemicals or no fertilizer simply because they cannot afford to buy. And they do no pruning or no weeding at all. So the forest, coffee cultivation in East Timor is can be said environment conserving. They are actually creating forests, and which means the coffee cultivation in East Timor is bird friendly. Next slide. So this is the coffee garden. No, actually, I may call it a coffee forest. And as you can see, the coffee can grow easily without pruning at the height of 5 meters. And the small boy have to climb up to pick up the cherry. And behind the coffee tree, you can see the RBG, the Paraseniensis falcataria, one of two shade tree, which is planted in East Timor. Okay, next slide, please. So this is a forest. And man-made forests. But beneath this shade tree, there's a coffee. So this is a coffee forest. Again, this is a topography of the East Timor. You can see the below, there's a forest. This is another shade tree, a castellina tree. And again, under this castellina tree, there is a coffee production. Only the coffee cultivated, we can see the forest. Okay, next. So, but this environmental conserving coffee cultivation, that it remained low and poor quality. Actually, potentially, this Arabic coffee is high quality, but due to the poor harvest and the poor post-harvest technique, the quality remains very low, and the purchase price also remained very, very low. And why the people do not try to improve the coffee quality? Is it difficult to improve the coffee quality of the coffee? Actually, not at all. It's very, very simple. No high tech or no cost of the improving. But why people are not, for example, this is selecting the high quality beans. Even the small children can do it. And why are the coffee growing community really interested in improving quality of their coffee? Because little access to knowledge or method for improving quality and adding value. And also they are cut off from outside market. There's only one agent or buyer in East Timor, and they are buying coffee with fixed price. And this local price does not reflect real market price. So there's a weak incentive to improve the quality of the coffee. Okay, so we made a project to improve this situation, putting the local farmer or producer in global context and improving agroecological harvesting and processing technique, which was assisted by the coffee company, PT Toarco Toraja in Indonesia. They warmly welcomed coffee cultivator of East Timor to their Toraja area, where, and they can communicate in Bahasa easily, thanks for the Pete Toraja, Toarco Toraja. And also the empowering the producer by promoting consumer public to select green product, and those is to improve the cultivator status within the commodity chain. Okay, so next one, please. Okay, next. I'm going too fast. Okay, next one. Okay, next one. Wow. Next one. Okay. So, okay, this is, so everybody is putting too many things to the green economy, but for me, it seems there's a three pillar for green economy. The one is a quality product, and the other one is a quality environment, and the third one is economic viability. And to connect these three things, okay, next one, please. Mediation is important. Mediation through the social relationship. This is the key to achieve the green economy. Next one, please. Fair trade. This is just what is fair trade? Also, this is many meaning. But for me, this is just linked between the production side and the consumer side. For the production side, emphasizing the environmental conservation or coffee quality to add the value in the international market. And for consumption side, inspires consumers to know how and by whom the commodity they can consume and produce. So this is a very important thing. Next slide, please. Okay, so these small girls are actually producing the coffee in East Timor. And you may, okay, next one, please. You may think this is, okay, child labor. Actually not. This is a family work. Of course, this situation is not best, but it is not child labor to be blamed. Okay, next one, please. So the old men also, old women also helping to collect the coffee. Okay, next. So the linkage beyond the marketplace, that's a very significant to improve the quality of the, improving the quality of the connection to overcome the not in my backyard sentiment and also to overcome dichotomy of producer and the consumer. So consumer should be the co-producer if properly connected. Okay, next one, please. And another significant thing is the pride of skilled production. That's important for the people there. Increased confidence from gaining adequate livelihood and maintaining family or their environment enhancing activity can be get from this skill of production and the pride of that. So, okay, next one, pride. Next slide, please. So family agriculture, this is a year of the family agriculture which United Nations has designated, and it is said there are over 500 million family farms, and also there are they are responsible for at least 56% of agricultural product on 56% of the land. And in the case of the coffee, 70% are coming from the small the family cultivation. And if that is so, green economy never realized without the, okay, last one, please, the small farmers' pride for future. That's what I want to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Ken-ichi.
So we face a lot of challenges. Next, please. Yeah, we learned from almost 35 years of commercial logging in Indonesia, and it seemed that the local community, they don't get substantial, you know, access to the forest. It also, at the end, a lot of territorial conflict and social unrest, but because they don't have any enough land, and especially in Sumatra and Kalimantan, and right now there are problem of illegal logging still, and the extent of the illegal oil palm plantation is the common problem in Sumatra and Kalimantan, in forests and land fire, illegal forest conversion and land selling, illegal land selling and so on. It's happened. One of the reasons is also because of the weak of law enforcement. This is the problem we face. Next, please. And we we think that social forestry is could be an appropriate solution. We provide access to the local community, to the farmer who work near the forest area or in the forest area. And we secure the access for them for 35 years at least. We guarantee access. They manage the state forest for quite numbers of years. Next, please. But unfortunately, it is not easy when we set up a policy to put almost 22 million hectares of state forest land for the local people, but the proposal from the Bupati forest district is only about 800,000 hectares, so less than half. And the proposal go to Jakarta and we process the proposal from the district, but there are many problems and only 300,000 hectares we can issue the permit. And even when the ministry issued the permit for about 300,000 hectares for forest community, there is still a problem that the district level only can issue 80,000 hectares. It's very, very small portion. So we face the problem of it seemed to me that the local district, they are not willing to put this social forestry program into their priority, even though that the proposal is coming from their people in that district. So it is something surprising for me. Maybe if the proposal coming from mining, it's a different story. This for the people, local people, is of course this program is very important, but a local district, local politician, they look at a different way. Lanjut, go ahead. For the hutan desa is quite interesting because the national target is 500,000, but the proposal is more than the national target. It's more than 700,000 hectare. And again, there is a problem that we until now we just issued 266,000 hectare. And support from the governor is also very weak, except the governor from Jambi. I know Jambi is because there is a warsi there, and West Sumatra province is very eager to put a lot of hutan desa in that province and so on. So the social forestry project is very much not only problem at Jakarta level, but also there is a problem at the provincial and district level to support this program. Go ahead. The common characteristic of soil forestry in ASEAN. Go ahead, please. This is the common at the ASEAN country. Community living in surrounding forests and empowerment of the community. in sustainable forest management through awareness raising, capacity building, and so on. Participation of and the provision of right is very important. Go ahead. Social forestry program activities and improving community livelihood. The social forestry enterprise development, developing non-timber forest product, upstream and downstream linkage is also becoming the concern across the country at the ASEAN level. Go ahead. Multi-stakeholder engagement for bamboo in social forestry program. We just have Indonesia Council on Bamboo's development, Indonesia Bamboo Foundation, and so on. Facilitation and partnership in the community, in the bamboo cultivation, and enterprise development for bamboo product from forest areas. Go ahead. Multi-stakeholder engagement for natural sites, also one of the program we have across ministerial partnership, forestry, industry, trade, small and medium enterprises, tourism, and creative economy. Go ahead. Multi-stakeholder engagement in agarwood, forest honey, and rattan. As we know already, GMHI and the we have a centra for many non-timber forest product. Rattan, for instance, is also one of our concern. Go ahead. Research commitment needed for ensuring sustainable social forestry. There are social forestry evaluation, research that solidify the economic environment and socio-cultural values of social forestry is very important. Research on the right tree for the right place, scientifically proven recommendation for selection of trees and social forestry practices. Research on market demand, market potential, risk, and cost. Go ahead.
But will you be able to wrap up in 1 minute?
1 minute, okay. Investment required for social forestry and sustainable value chain. Investment from central and local government and budget allocation for social forestry. Investment from private sector through focus group discussion, multi-stakeholder processes, and demanding relevant added value for social forestry, product branding, marketing, benefit sharing. Investment from social, from local community. Go ahead.
Thank you very much, Pak Wiratno, for sharing the results, activities, and challenges of social forestry. We thank you, Dr. Padoch, for your short input.
I'm to fewer than those. So I will attempt to make a few comments. I'll attempt to make them sort of vaguely coherent, although I doubt that I'm going to reach that. And I'm going to do it very, very quickly. What I think, you know, since I can only make about two or three points, I think what we've seen here are several very interesting examples, very important examples of how research institutions, government institutions, outreach, training can work, and the private sector can actually work within smallholder systems, both to enhance not only environments, forests, sustainable landscapes, but also livelihoods of people. And I think it's important. I think it's important that the idea of working within these institutions, actually within these systems, actually trying to build upon knowledge, trying to build upon local organization, trying to build upon in what the environment offers, trying to build upon traditions of management, traditions that are valued for various reasons, rather than trying to replace them. I think this morning, for instance, we heard about some visions of green economy and some that could possibly be and probably are quite profitable for smallholders. But I think there are other models, and I think we've heard here about these other models, where smallholders are not just tiny little industrial producers. They're not just feeding into an industrial process, but actually there are ways, there are other models of a green economy, there are other models of enhancing smallholder systems, of linking the private sector with communities. Community producers, you know, this is such an enormous private sector, actually. And to offer another model, which perhaps should not be the only model, but it is a model we also need, of what green economy can mean and what enhancing local communities can actually mean. So I think that what we've seen here is both an enrichment of that knowledge, an enrichment of that discussion of what green economy can be, and also it's, I think, very important for updating what local communities really are. I mean, often we focus very much just on how remote they are, and many of them are remote, but also many of them are participating in markets quite effectively. And none of this is very easy, but this is a challenge that all of our institutions and all of us, I think, need to work on. I would also like to add just one little thing, and I promise this will be sort of one sentence or so, on the idea of updating our ideas of what the local communities are and what they can be. And I think often that somehow eludes us, and it's actually something that we're also working on in the ASFCC projects and in the ASEAN Social Forestry Network, also understanding just how mobile, not only how linked to other communities smallholders can be, but how mobile they are, and understanding this sort of diversity of how they make their livelihoods, also to understand, for instance, the importance of migration and remittances these days. And if we're going to talk about some of these value chains and we're going to talk about investment, maybe we should also talk about attempts to really to both to understand and to channel remittances. All of these communities have people who have gone to cities, many of whom have even gone overseas, and are looking for ways also, I think, to successfully invest what they bring back, and for families to successfully capture that and invest. And I think this is yet another area, if I may add to this conversation, another area which again may sort of level the playing field a bit more for smallholders, and can also add new and more sort of profound meaning to what green economy actually can be. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Christine, for your inputs.
You mentioned there are share, of course, among actors along the value chains. You mentioned about farmers, you mentioned about the marketing. And what is surprising is about, you mentioned about the share to NGO, which is 20%. So does it mean that NGO take over the roles of middlemen? I think that's my question.
After I find the market, don't leave me, because it takes almost 18 months to meet MWA, approved by MWA. So that is time investment, and so we need trust. I also, their partner is Pak Irawan. We shake hand, three of us. Pak Irawan, please guide the quality. Don't your people mix with sugar, and I get claim from market. Please don't happen. Yeah, we three of us, we trust each other, the integrity. Because the we need the same commitment to start this long term. To marketing, we need a stamina to do everything. Networking. This is networking marketing, yeah? Not tengkulak, not a middleman. This is a long term commitment between us. Until now, we keep our honor to ourselves, and I still do the marketing, whatever hard the job, I do it. And asking about the profit sharing, think it's not the take over the profit. No. Like a rewards. Profit sharing is profit and risk taking. So when they sell the price to Dia Niaga, say 90,000 rupiah, we pay 90,000 rupiah. And then after we marketing to MWA, that is a market, a profit margin again. That is split to 30% for indigenous people group, 20% for NGO who facilitating them, and 10% for association. This, we need our own pocket money. So the jaringan is not depend too much to donor. With we have free to do what we think is good. And marketing take a 40%. That is the SOP of JMHI. Thank you.